Chad, appreciate your time this morning. We are going to get into Arkansas-Tennessee basketball tonight, but I do want to start with the football program in Knoxville. I know that you're a graduate, big-time fan, grew up with the program. And when Arkansas played Tennessee this year, I felt like it was a tale of two teams. One was trending in the right direction. One was trending in the wrong. Hogs got the win. Now there's rumors floating about Jeremy Pruitt, Gus Malzahn, Hugh Freeze. Man, just give us kind of a feel of what's going on with the Knoxville football program right now.
Yeah, thanks for having me on, guys. I think it's in a holding pattern right now. That's the best way to put it. With this NCAA investigation, and you've also got rumors and people talking about, well, why did this NCAA investigation come about? Is this something that normally would be handled internally? If someone blew the whistle on something that went on with a recruit in Tennessee, is it Tennessee sort of self-sabotaging themselves in order to get Jeremy Pruitt fired because people at Tennessee want him gone, is one possibility. But I think that's where we are right now. Philip Fulmer, clearly, he had that statement when they accepted the bid of the Liberty Bowl before they had to back out because of COVID-19, talking about a great development opportunity for this roster and for Jeremy Pruitt going into year four. So I think it's pretty clear that Philip Fulmer, the guy who hired Jeremy Pruitt, wants him to get a fourth year, wants to tell everyone, hey, it was a weird year for everyone this year with this COVID season. He had won 8 straight games, and then they fell off a cliff for whatever reason. And I guess whatever reasons Jeremy Pruitt gave Philip Fulmer was good enough for him to say, okay, you deserve one more year. Let's turn this thing around and figure it out. But there's a lot of people in Knoxville that don't want him to have a fourth year, that feel like the writing's on the wall, and they've already seen enough from Jeremy Pruitt, even after a great turnaround in 2019. So, where's the program right now in terms of Jeremy Pruitt and leadership? I think I would sit around and wait to see if he's allowed to hire a coach. He's got 2 coaching vacancies right now. He's got an offensive line coach to hire and a defensive line coach to hire. They've yet to make a hire. Well, why is that? Well, that's because he's not allowed to do anything until they're sure he's going to be the coach next year. So I think if they announce a hire on that staff, that's a pretty good indication that Philip Fulmer has won and Jeremy Pruitt will be back in 2021. Until then, I think, like myself and a lot of other people, they're just sitting around waiting to see if Tennessee's going to pull a Texas. Then, remove one coach and hire another one on the same day. Because I do think that's how it would probably go down this time. I don't know that there's going to be a big search. I think it would be you have someone in place that's agreed to it, and you do both at the same time.
Chad, the basketball program is a completely different world than the football team. Rick Barnes has this Tennessee Volunteer squad as probably, and I think it's pretty consensus, the number one team in the SEC. I wonder from your perspective, like what that arena, and I know Thompson Bowling isn't full, but what he's kind of done with the basketball program as of late. I have some friends that went to Tennessee, some sports radio people I know. The nickname Regular Season Rick has gotten tossed around, not only with his time in Tennessee, but also at Texas. What does this team look like to you, and how do you think they'll perform in the postseason with all the talent they have down there in Knoxville?
Well, I think it's the perfect model for what the football team should be looking at, honestly. It is what the culture that Rick Barnes has built with the basketball program. This is a sustainable thing, right? He did it originally with a bunch of 2- and 3-star players that he developed into NBA players. Grant Williams, Admiral Schofield, Jordan Bone was a 4-star guy coming in. But guys like that that became the core of that team that were looked over by pretty much every other big program, and he developed them into SEC champions. Then once that started happening, he started bringing in 5-star players. Josiah Jordan-James a year ago, Jaden Springer, Keon Johnson this year. 2 5-star guys, by the way, that come off the bench for this Tennessee team. So that shows the depth of this squad, that they have 2 5-star freshmen, one of which is probably a one-and-done and a lottery pick that comes off the bench for this team. It also shows the ultimate buy-in and selfless approach of this roster. Look, it's easier to do in basketball when you're talking about, 12, 15 guys that you have on a team at all times and a football roster that's a lot bigger. But I think that's sort of the model for what Tennessee football should strive to be, is what Rick Barnes has accomplished with this basketball program. And, hey, regular season Rick or not, I think Tennessee fans would take 3 or 4 months of joy that they've seen with this basketball program over the last few years, and a one disappointing game in the tournament, as opposed to the alternative, which is zero success in basketball. So I think Rick Barnes has done a terrific job. And this Tennessee team is very good, but as they showed on Saturday, guys, at Alabama, they're capable of laying an egg just like anyone else. They were terrible in that game. Alabama played great. They were 8-for-11 from three in the second half. So that's why tonight's matchup scares me a little bit on the Tennessee end, because when you get teams that run a lot and shoot high-volume threes, there's always an X factor with those teams. If they're hot, they're almost impossible to beat. If they're not making, it's almost impossible for those teams to win. So I really thought this stretch was going to be an interesting one for Tennessee, with Alabama and Arkansas both coming to Knoxville back-to-back.
You mentioned, you know, the threes and Arkansas's ability to shoot from the perimeter and defend the perimeter. Which set of matchups interest you more in this game? Is it the guard play and Victor Bailey Jr. And Moses Moody and that set of guards from each team? Or is it the inside play tonight with Fulkerson and 7'3" inside man Connor Vanover, who likes to shoot the three from the outside? Which set of matchups tonight do you think weighs heavier in this game between Arkansas and Tennessee?
I think the best individual matchup is Fulkerson and Vanover, the 7'3" shooter, because that's the one where they could exploit Fulkerson. I think down low, Fulkerson can do a good job against him. He's so slight of frame. So I think he can do a good job down low. But, you mentioned it at the beginning. It's guard play. It's containing the three-point shot for Arkansas. It's the reason Tennessee lost against Alabama. I think it's a two-point game at halftime. Tennessee did a good job of limiting. They contested three-point attempts in the first half, and then in the second half, because Alabama did a good job in the first half of penetration, getting to the rim, did a great job of getting open threes and knocking them down, and it put the game away. So that's what I'm watching for this Tennessee team, is just the bounce back from a disappointing performance in their SEC home opener on Saturday, and how they defend the three against Arkansas. And look, we're going to see it with some of the better teams in the SEC, and I'm putting Tennessee, Missouri, Alabama, Arkansas, that round robin is definitely some of the better teams in the SEC that what I've seen this year. Tennessee goes to Missouri and absolutely hammers them. It's 23-4 before you can blink, and the game's over. And it was never close, and Tennessee's up 30 at one point in the game. And then Missouri goes to Arkansas and wins, which surprised me. And then Alabama comes to Knoxville and wins, which surprised me. So I think we're going to see some interesting matchups in that round robin of the top four or five teams this conference. And I'm putting Tennessee and Arkansas in that top four or five.
Yeah, then Missouri goes and loses again last night. Give our audience an idea that I think a lot of people probably just saw the final score of Tennessee losing to Alabama, but probably didn't see the game, maybe saw some highlights. What happened in that game? Because from an Arkansas perspective, you just see the score and you think, man, you can't catch Tennessee at a worse time coming off a loss, because you know you're going to get their undivided attention and full focus. Arkansas comes off a horrible home performance. So exactly how did that unfold, and how did Alabama best Tennessee this past weekend?
I think two things happened. I think Tennessee, honestly, they experienced adversity for the first time this season. They were 7-0. They had wins over Colorado, who's a top 20 net ranking team. Went over Cincinnati. They went at Missouri easily. You thought their first SEC road game was going to be a challenge, and it really wasn't. And they come home and they face a little bit of adversity against Alabama. They're not playing well. They're not shooting well. I don't think they handled it well. I think Alabama gave them a lot of chances to get back in that game and win it. It was a 7 or 6 point game for a good 4 or 5 minute stretch, second half, where neither team scored. So I don't think Tennessee handled adversity well the first time they've seen it all year. So how do they bounce back and play with it during adversity the rest of the way? But also, it was just a disjointed effort from the start. Tennessee's offense was just a little bit out of sync. Alabama's guards did a great job of penetrating. That's a big concern against Arkansas, was Tennessee keeping the guards in front of them. It was way too easy for them to get to the basket and finish in this game. And they relied too heavily on the perimeter. Look, Tennessee is a balanced team in terms of how they score. They can go down low. They can penetrate. They can occasionally shoot the three. They're not a high-volume three-point shooting team. If they're shooting a ton of threes, something's wrong. And they shot a ton of threes and a ton of outside shots against Alabama, and something was definitely wrong for that reason.
Talking with Chad Withrow, 104.5 The Zone here on The Morning Rush. Chad, let's shift the conversation to college football. This is breaking from AL.com that the college football playoff on Monday might get moved because of COVID cases within the Ohio State program. Chad, in your opinion, if Ohio State has enough people to play but there's still COVID issues, should they play that game on Monday night?
Yes, they should play. When you say if they have enough people to play, are you talking about the 53-man deal?
53 position group. Group, all that stuff.
Which turned out to be kind of like a guideline and not a rule, right? Mm-hmm. For the SEC. It was still, hey, this is what we're going to go by, but you can just cancel the game whenever you want if you declare that you have COVID issues throughout the season. So I think Ohio State's doing a little bit of that. Personally, I think that unless they have, let's say their entire offensive and defensive line have COVID, you know, then yeah, let's move the game. But if it's a few players out, I think they should play the game as scheduled. I also want to see both teams with a full complement of players because I think it's got a chance to be a pretty good game. If Ohio State plays like they did against Clemson, I think it's going to be a good national championship game. So look, the football fan in me, the competitor in me wants to see the two best possible teams on the field. But from a what is right and what is wrong in a pandemic season, I think with the limited hands that teams have had to play with throughout the season, if it's just a couple players that are out and you're trying to mask that and say it's a huge outbreak, I think they should probably play the game as scheduled.
Ohio State's due a break, though. I mean, they need to probably give them an edge here. They hadn't had a break in a long time. So.
Yeah, that's a program really that's been down on their luck for so long, guys. You know, sure. They continue to get slided by their own conference and the NCAA over and over again.
Trust me, of course,
I'm kidding.
Yeah, Chad, Arkansas fans know that all too well. When five players were supposed to be suspended for the Sugar Bowl in 2011, they let them play and then they left the following year. So they know that all too well. Chad, last question before we let you go, man. We really appreciate your time this morning. We saw Devontae Smith win the Heisman last night. I was ecstatic. I thought he deserved it. You got two Heisman winners competing this week in your own backyard. Lamar Jackson, Derrick Henry. Ravens as the home team, as the visiting team, favored this weekend. Now, we know last time what happened in a playoff game when the Ravens were favored against the Titans. How do you see that game shaking out in Nissan Stadium this weekend?
It's a crazy rivalry in the playoffs because the road team's always won. You know, they've played four times. The Titans have won both games, including last year in Baltimore. Baltimore's won both games in Nashville. So it's a little weird that way, and that's why you see the Ravens the favorite in this game. And the Ravens are on a five-game winning streak, so I understand all of that. Look, the Titans know how to defend Lamar Jackson, and it's pretty simple. Even though the Titans have a terrible defense, the Ravens are dead last in passing offense in the league. And the Titans' biggest problem is stopping the pass. So this is the matchup you want to see from that perspective. You keep Lamar Jackson in the pocket. You know, with a lot of quarterbacks, you're trying to force them to move, force them out of the pocket. You don't want Lamar Jackson out of the pocket. You bottle him up. You contain rush. You make him throw to beat you. And that has been the formula, and it has worked for the Titans. It worked when they beat them this regular season. It worked when they went up to Baltimore and won in the divisional round a year ago. That is the formula for the Titans. And let's face it, guys, this defense is historically bad for the Titans, but for the Titans franchise, this offense is historically good with Derrick Henry, with Ryan Tannehill, with A.J. Brown. This offense is dynamic. I think 40 is the goal. I really do. I think it's an offense that needs to put up 40 points to win in the playoffs. And that's got to be the goal every single time they go out if they're going to have a chance to advance.
Love and Wild Card Weekend starts on Saturday. Really excited to get the NFL playoffs back in a swing in a situation where some people didn't even think we were going to get to this point. Chad Withrow, 104.5 The Zone there in Nashville. Biggest Tennessee fan, one of the biggest I know. Chad, we really appreciate your time this morning. Hopefully this game will at least be enjoyable tonight from both perspectives.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a good game, guys. So good luck. It should be fun. And I think Arkansas has got a good team and a good thing going with Eric Musselman. So it's going to be fun to watch both these teams this year. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Two rising programs in the SEC. Rick Barnes heading up the Volunteers and Eric Musselman heading up the Hogs.